Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord.
Mission Hills Church, how are we doing today? All right. Hey, you guys are better than the first service. I got a little cheer. Woo! Happy to be here today. If we have not met, my name is Allison Hoyer, and I have the great privilege of serving as our elementary and family ministry pastor here at Mission Hills. If you are a guest with us this morning, we are so excited to have you join us, and we would love an opportunity to get to know you. There's a couple of ways we can do that. You can fill out the Connect card that you got as you came in this morning and return that to the offering boxes at the back of the worship center. Or you can visit our Welcome Center. There are some wonderful volunteers there who would love to meet you, and they can answer any questions you might have. Also, guests, you will not want to miss next Sunday. You ready? Next Sunday, after the 11 a.m. service, we are having my favorite thing. A taco lunch. Oh, you know how much I love tacos. I will be there. Guests, your tacos are on us, so please, I hope you'll join us. If you are here this morning and you would like prayer, we would love a chance to pray with you. You can write your prayer requests on your Connect card or at the end of the service. There will be some people up front, and they would love to pray with you as well. I want to thank you all as you continue to give to the ministry of Mission Hills Church. Giving can be done through our website by clicking on the Give tab, or you can use the offering boxes at the back of the worship center. All right, guys, I want to invite you next Wednesday night, 6:30, we are having a night of prayer and worship. This is going to be a wonderful opportunity for us to come together, start the new year off by praying for our church and worshiping our amazing God. This is something we are inviting everyone to, kids, teenagers, parents, grandparents, everybody. We will have childcare for kids 5 and under, but everybody is welcome and we hope to see you there. Last up, if you are not yet plugged into a life group, this is your opportunity. We have new life groups launching on the week of January 16th. And this is a great way where you can make new friends and learn and grow in community. So if you'd like more information about our groups, or if you want to register, you can visit our Welcome Center. That's it for me. So I invite you now to stand as we continue to worship.
Let me Lord's always good to us.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within. You work miracles. does. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. And I'm still in your hands. This is my comfort. this church and in our hearts, Lord, we thank you for your presence. In your name we pray, amen. It's awesome to worship with you guys, as always. Before we take a seat, let's say hi to the people around us.
You already did? Well, you should say hi to someone else.
Well, happy New Year, Mission Hills Church, and any one of you who might be here for the first time. It really is a happy New Year. We're kind of glad to put 2021 behind us. I don't know how you spent New Year's Day. I happened to spend New Year's Day at the Rose Bowl, and that was a great way to spend it. I grew up in Pasadena, so going to the Rose Bowl and the Rose Parade before that every New Year's was sort of a family tradition. And so we got to go to Pasadena to the Rose Bowl. And this was actually a rather meaningful experience because, as you may know, our son Tomas, he's a junior at Ohio State, and Ohio State was in the Rose Bowl. So this was a little bit more meaningful to actually have a team in the game and have a chance to watch them play. And of course, if you watch the game on TV, or perhaps if you were at the game, you witnessed an incredible comeback by Ohio State in the waning moments of the game as they beat University of Utah 48-45. So it was just a great New Year's for me. And to say nothing of the fact that as a lifelong Bruin, it's kind of nice to have a team that actually wins. So no offense to my fellow Bruins, but I tell you, Ohio State, what a football team. So anyways, it was a great New Year's Day. But I guess I must have sat near somebody. I mean, there are 100,000 people there. But I came in contact with someone that had COVID because 3 days after the New Year's game, I came down with COVID. And that's why we're doing it this way this morning. I wish I could be with you, but I'm still contagious. So I'm here in a room all by myself, and we'll just keep it this way. But I will be around this week. I'm in day 5, I believe, of my isolation. And so by midweek, this coming week, I'll be up and around and wearing a mask, but up and around. And then I certainly will be back on Sunday, the coming next week, and looking forward to preaching. So please forgive me. My thoughts, let's just say it's a little bit more difficult to think and to communicate with my head congested and kind of going through the symptoms of COVID. But I am doing well. I think I'm on the rebound, so to speak. So, but before we jump in, I wanted to let you know. I tell you, I don't know what the best words are to express how grateful I am. It sounds a bit shallow to say it even that way, how grateful, right? It's sort of a typical word, but I don't know what the best word is to describe how I feel about all of you as a church. You are so incredibly faithful to God, and it shows in so many ways. And finances just happens to be one of them. I tell you every year that December, we budget it to be a double giving month. And well, this last December, last month, we more than doubled our giving. So thank you for trusting God. Thank you for asking him what you should do. And thank you for following his lead. So your generosity and your faith in God and your sacrificial giving, it really now allows us to be set up well for the second half of our fiscal year. So don't stop giving, but thank you. Thank you. Your heart of faith and trust and sacrifice, it blesses God. It's just a great act of worship, the way that you give. And speaking of giving, in October, we launched Ready India, our campaign to raise $340,000 to plant a church in every village of the entire district or county of Nizamabad, India, in the state of Telangana, India. And we are, let's just say, pretty much there. Of the $340,000, by December 31st, we had committed to all but $1,208. The exact amount, $338,792,000, has been committed by you for India. And of that pledged amount, $216,000 has already been given, has already been sent to Operation Saturation. And so I'll give you more details about the churches that are being planted and the buildings that are being constructed and the conversions that, to Christ that are happening in the weeks ahead. But, oh my goodness, what a glorious way to end 2021. And I simply want to let you know I'm grateful. I'm really grateful. Well, about every third summer growing up, and I think I've shared this with you before, but our family, we used to always take trips back to Boston. And about every third summer, we'd pack our family of five, three boys, mom and dad, into our family's 1968 Ford Econoline van. We called it the White Whale. And we set out from our home in Pasadena, headed for 16 Pine Ridge Road in Arlington, Massachusetts. 3,200 miles of U.S. interstate highway right out before us. And those were quite the journeys that we took. But if you've ever taken a long journey like that, you know it doesn't take long for boredom to set in, especially if you're only 9 years old, right? And let's just say I'm easily bored. If, within an hour, I'm asking my dad, "Hey, Dad, when are we going to get there?" To which my father would respond, "Brian, we'll get there when we get there." And it didn't matter how many times, and believe me, there were many, many times I asked that question. It didn't matter how many times, my dad always said the same thing. "Brian, we'll get there when we're going to get there. We'll get there when we get there." It, I think it was just his way of shutting me up, and can I blame him? I mean, he's got three boys, 11, 9, and 4, in the back of his van, a bunch of squirrely kids, and he's got what amounted to be 3 days of nonstop driving before we reached our destination. So, anyways, I really haven't changed much. I mean, if, when I get in a car today, it doesn't have to be a transcontinental drive. It could be just a drive to LA or a drive, I don't know, somewhere, San Diego. And I always want to know, how long is it going to take me to get there? What's the fastest route? And how long will it take before I get there? Well, I'll come back to that in just a minute. But prior to the Christmas season, we were making our way through the book of Genesis. Its theme follows its structure, and that would be this: creation, fall, and then redemption. And redemption is another word for salvation. So God creates, mankind rebels, we call that mankind falls, and then God spends all of his time and energy and effort doing what? Rescuing us, devising a plan, and then initiating that plan to save, to rescue, to redeem mankind. That's the theme of Genesis: creation, fall, and redemption. When we last looked at the book of Genesis before we came into the Christmas season, we were considering the amazing life of Noah. Well, now it's January 2022. And as I began thinking about getting back into the book of Genesis as we approach this new year, I'm really convinced that there's no better biblical character, there's no better historical figure whose life could be considered for us, that would be important for us to consider for this new year, than the life of Noah. He's the perfect character to look at as we enter the year 2022. So I'm only going to take a little bit of time this morning refreshing your memory, or if you're here for the first time, maybe helping you see some things for the first time related to the life of Noah. Having COVID, let's just say this has been a tough week trying to get my head around studying for the next chapter. So what I've decided to do, beyond obviously needing to do this by way of recording, I'm just condensing it a bit. I'm going to reset the stage, remind you of some of what we've studied related to Noah, and then give us one thought from the life of Noah that we can apply as we enter into the initial days of 2022. And then next week, we'll jump into chapter 9. So we'll primarily be looking at some of what we've already seen in chapter 8. Anyway, I appreciate your patience with me, but let's take some moments, though, and be reminded about this stellar, stellar man of faith. Well, Adam. All right, not Noah, but Adam. Who was Adam? Well, Adam was the only man on earth. right? He's the only man on earth. Adam was the only man on earth because he was the first man on earth. When we think about Noah, he too was the only man on earth, but not because he was the first. He was the only man on earth because he was the last one. Now, granted, he had his wife, his three sons, and their wives. There were eight of them. But Noah is the central figure, the one God is working through and communicating with. And so, if you will, he is the only man. He's the last man standing. There's a big difference from being the only man on earth when you're the first human being ever created, you're the first one, and being the only man on earth and you're the last one remaining after the judgment. So what I'm trying to say is that Noah experienced a trauma that Adam never did. Noah was literally the last man standing. So imagine being Noah. God calls you to build an enormous ark. And as you do, he says, you're not only an ark builder, you are my prophet. You are my mouthpiece. You are my spokesperson. And you need to tell everybody that the end is going to happen. Judgment for everyone is going to fall, that people need to get right with God. So you've got two enormous tasks on your hands. And who really wants to be the bearer of that news, that judgment is coming? But Noah, being a man who trusted God, he does precisely what God asked him to do. Well, then much time passed, and the day eventually came. And God says to Noah, you've got 1 week, get all the animals into the ark, and then you get into the ark. And so he does just that. It took him a week to do it, and then he gets his family in there. Noah's the last one in, and God shuts him in. He shuts him in. Noah had no sail, no rudder, no steering device. He was holed up inside that ark, nothing more than a tiny cork relative to the water around it, bobbing up and down with the waves in the open seas. You can't really call it a voyage. It wasn't a voyage. A voyage sets out in a particular direction with a specific destination in mind. But around Noah and the ark, there are no coastlines. There's no more land, only endless ocean and pointless horizons. This was literally water world. No place to go and no hurry to get there. The sun, it's nowhere to be seen or felt. Above you are dark thunderclouds releasing endless downpours of rain, thunder, and lightning. Beneath you, all that remains, somewhere in the deep, are the lifeless corpses of every human being and every creature on the now fully submerged earth. Darkness above, death below, and no end in sight. And God chose not to do something. How convenient, right? He chose not to tell Noah how long he'd be in the ark. He didn't tell him any of that. He just said, get in. And the last thing Noah heard was the sound of that one door being shut from the outside. And then it's latched. That's the last he heard of God, was the sound of the door shutting. Think how that played with his emotions in the days to come. Day after day after really endless day. But Noah, how can he count? He really can't see the sun. So when did that day end and when did the next day begin? He's living in an endless storm. Noah was entombed in darkness, as one commentator said. He was entombed in darkness and in mystery. That's just how God decided it should be for Noah. See, on our family excursions across the United States in that white van of ours, at least I had some sense that we were making progress. I could see the land go by as my dad drove, right? So however slow it might be, there was at least there was a destination that I could ask about. And not only that, but I actually received an answer from my dad. I spoke to my dad and he responded. Now, my dad didn't give me the detail I wanted, but at least I heard his voice. I knew he heard me, and I knew that he understood my question. The last thing Noah heard, again, it was just the shut of the door of the ark. That's it. ask as he might, he heard nothing from God. Nothing. Zero. Wow. And all the while knowing that all of humanity in those moments is perishing. Judgment. Well, and should we think that Satan was somehow attending to other matters, there were no other human beings to torment, tempt, deceive, or accuse. They're all dead. So for him, Satan that is, the ark, Noah's ark, was like the Garden of Eden all over again. All of humanity is right there. Noah, his wife, three sons, and their wives. So, Noah, I must commend you on your obedience to God. But how's it working out for you, Noah? You don't even know what day it is, do you? I mean, at least God told you, though, how many days you'd be at sea in this storm. He did, right? He told you how long this would go on. Oh, I see. You don't even have that information. Well, that's interesting. Hey, tell me, Noah, have you ever thought that God might just be toying with you? He hasn't spoken with you. I mean, you don't have any information. Maybe God's just toying with you. All he said to you was get in the ark, but there's no mention of getting out of the ark, right? So maybe this is your tomb, Noah. Maybe your death is just as sure as all the rest. Matter of fact, I bet that's what's going on. I mean, have you wondered why the silence? I'm sure he loves you, and I'm sure he knows you could use a little reassurance. Am I right? Of course you could. Well, I wonder where God is then. Kind of makes a person wonder what's up, don't you think? So in what ways did Satan torment Noah and his family in all that darkness? Over all that period of time, God shut Noah in, and then there's nothing to be seen of God, nothing to be heard from God. That must have been traumatic. While writing about Noah's experience in the ark, Martin Luther wrote this. He said, "There's nothing that we are less able to tolerate than a God who does not remember, but who has forgotten us." Well, maybe you felt God has forgotten you in this past year. These haven't been easy months, 2020 or 2021. But Noah's life reminds us that that is not the case ever. God doesn't forget his own. In truth, God had never forgotten Noah. And as we read the story, we come to chapter 8, verse 1, and it opens with these words. The words that are most comforting, and the words are these: but God remembered Noah and all the wild animals as well, and all the livestock that were with him in the ark, and he sent a wind over the earth, and the waters receded. And when the Old Testament says that God remembers, what it's doing is it's combining the ideas of faithful love and timely intervention. That's in the Hebrew mindset what the word remember conjures up when it's applied to God. When God remembers, it combines the ideas of faithful love and timely intervention. God is a God whose love is faithful. And in a moment that he chooses, he intervenes on behalf of his beloved. And that's what's happening here. He's moving toward the object of his memory. He didn't forget. He didn't forget Noah as if we might forget something on the stove. He doesn't do that. It's his faithful love being applied in a practical way at a timely moment. That's what it means that God is remembering. So it was time for God to remember, to act visibly on behalf of the ones he loved, Noah and his family and the livestock, every living creature in that ark. And so how does he remember? He remembers by causing the water to recede. He didn't say anything to Noah. He just knew after 150 days, of torment, of downpour, of darkness and mystery, the waters began to recede. It says it this way, and he sent a wind over the earth and the waters receded. That's verse 1, the end of verse 1 of chapter 8. And I'm sorry you don't have any of these verses on the screen because you have my lovely face on the screen. But if you have your Bible, I'll just be reading some of the verses out of chapter 8 in the next few moments if you want to follow along. But I'll read them for you so you'll get it. So up to this point in the story, the flood has been the story. The flood has been the focal point of the story. And the flood refers to, or was in a very literal sense, it was righteous judgment. So righteous judgment is the focus of the story up to this point in chapter 8. But from this verse on, chapter 1, verse 8, as the waters recede, now the story begins to show the central features of grace, rescue, salvation, and redemption. I'll read a couple more verses from chapter 8. Now the springs of the deep and the floodgates of the heavens had been closed, and the rain had stopped falling from the sky. The water receded steadily from the earth. At the end of 150 days, the water had gone down, and on the 17th day of the 7th month, the ark came to rest, right, on the mountains of Ararat. That would be in a mountain range in Armenia. The waters continued to recede until the 10th month, and on the first day of the 10th month, the tops of the mountains became visible. Well, this is great. Finally, right? The water's receding. The boat's not bobbing up and down anymore. It's on terra firma, whatever we call it, right? It's on solid ground. So now the ordeal is over. How wonderful. 150 days adrift at sea, and now they're resting on solid rock. But here's the thing. God's communicating through the waters receding, but he still hasn't said anything. And no one knows enough not to leave the ark until God says so. So when you do the calculation based on the biblical evidence that we're given, Noah would spend another 200 days, 150 days in the midst of the flood, the storm, the darkness, and all that. Then it rests on Ararat. He just, oh, here we go. Let's go out. You know, we'll take a taxi to the bottom and start life over. No, they're in the ark another 200 days, a total of 1 year and 10 days inside that ark with those animals and his family. Man, God's asking a lot of Noah. And that's why Noah's a great figure to look at in our lives today, because God was asking things of Noah he's never asked of me. He's put Noah through a trauma I've never been through. And I doubt you've been through trauma to the degree that Noah has. Not to disparage or to depreciate your pain or your trauma or mine for that matter. But it's always good for us in life when our troubles mount, and they're real, but to look to those, either contemporaries or those that we know from Scripture, that endured far more and yet maintained their faith, because that gives us more courage to trust. And my goodness, over a year in that ark. But then God finally chooses to speak. Again, he remembered, and it's time for him to intervene again on behalf of his beloved. And it says in verse 15 of chapter 8, then God said, he says something. Thank you, God. You do speak. He says this to Noah. Noah, come out of the ark, you and your wife and your sons and their wives. Bring out every kind of living creature that is with you, the birds, the animals, and all the creatures that move along the ground, so they can multiply on the earth and be fruitful and increase in number on it. All right, life is starting over again. But how surreal those first moments on solid ground must have been. First of all, he's on a mountain, right? But for Noah, it's a whole new world. How far away was he when he got out of that ark from his pre-flood home? Well, he has no idea. He doesn't even know where he is. Talk about surreal. I mean, it's the world. There's blue sky. There's the earth. I'm here. My wife is here. My my sons and their wives. And God spoke, so we're okay. Wow. This is a whole new humanity. This is really starting over. Talk about a do-over. This is the do-over of all times. It's creation, take two. Noah and his wife were the new Adam and Eve. But notice that God's only instruction to Noah was to exit the ark with his family and then to disembark all the animals so that life could begin again. But Noah does something more than God says. And I'm not saying he was being disobedient. He was actually expressing his love and his gratitude and his faith in God. Verse 20 of Genesis 8 says this, "Then Noah built an altar to the Lord, and taking some of all the clean animals and the clean birds, some of them, he sacrificed them as burnt offerings on the altar that he built to the Lord." Noah builds an altar to God. In other words, Noah remembered the God who remembered him. The first act of the new human race was an act of worship. Oh my goodness. What a man is Noah. You see, Noah knew that the ark was God's grace, that he did not merit being spared. God could have just as righteously and justifiably annihilated Noah and his family as he did everybody else. Now, from God's perspective, he would say, "No, I saw something different in Noah, and that's why Noah was spared." Though not perfect, Noah had a heart that was still wanting to please me, follow me, worship me. And for that reason, I spared Noah. But Noah, from his perspective, knows, hey, but I'm not a perfect man. And so God has every reason, if he chose to, not to spare my life, but he did. Noah had learned over his life that those sinners deserve death, like himself, it is nevertheless possible for a substitute to take a sinner's place. Because that's what God had been teaching his people all through the millennia. That's what he's been teaching them. And Noah captured that lesson. That it is possible for a substitute to take a sinner's place. That's why an altar where animals are sacrificed, where blood is spilled, that's the whole symbol of a substitute. And God had told his people over the generations that he would accept the death, the shed blood of a substitute, of an animal, on behalf of his people for the forgiveness of their sins. And so that's what Noah's doing here. He's not setting up an altar for those that had already died. There's eight of them left. And he sets up this altar and he sacrifices the animals on it. He sheds their blood, knowing that God knows that what Noah is doing is acknowledging that eight of them need his forgiveness because they're far from perfect. He understood an innocent person or an innocent being may die instead. In the case of humans, instead of a fallen person. And this is what Noah's demonstrating when he exits the ark and builds this altar. And really, it's a symbol, as all of these animals that were sacrificed were. And obviously, it's only animals that are being sacrificed. It's a symbol, really, it's foreshadowing the ultimate innocent who would die as a substitute for mankind, and that would be Jesus Christ. The only human who was also God who could actually procure, cause to be effective as a substitute, dying in the place of humanity. And so this is really a foreshadowing of the cross of Jesus Christ, the innocent for the guilty. Well, this had been quite a year of trauma for Noah and his family, an experience of trauma that no other human could really imagine. So Noah had trauma behind him, and what did he have before him? He had uncertainty, didn't he? And maybe you feel some of that he was in that ark for a year. Now that year is over, right? And now our last year is over. Now, I don't know what trauma's been in it, But now we face a new year, and it doesn't mean that all those traumas have subsided. But there is a question about, we don't know everything in the future. We never do. So there's this sense of uncertainty before us. So if I'm Noah, the question isn't, when are we going to get there? They're there. They found that the there was Mount Ararat, and they got to get off the boat. So that's no longer the question. The question now is, what next? What next, God? Well, what we find is that Noah, as he made this altar to God, he was blessing God. And so you don't find Noah asking the question, what next? He's not asking the question about, God, what's tomorrow going to bring? Noah had learned through his pain that the most important thing that he could bring would be just a humble heart of gratitude. And that's also what that altar represented. And the Bible tells us that God could smell the aroma of that burning sacrifice, and it blessed his heart. In verse 21, the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma and said in his heart. Now here's God talking to himself. Never again will I curse the ground because of humans, even though every inclination of the human heart is evil from childhood. And never again will I destroy all living creatures as I have done. As long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night, those things will never cease. In other words, this is a covenant. And he's not making the formal covenant here. This is God, just, if you will, emotionally responding to the beauty of Noah's faith and Noah's sacrifice and Noah's devotion to him. It moved God. It moved God to say, for these eight, I'm going to start over. And I will not do ever again what I just did. And there will be winter, spring, summer, and fall. And then the following year, winter, spring, summer, and fall. And that cycle will continue on into the future for generations to come. Wow. The natural order of creation was restored. But still, I mean, the question's okay to... I mean, it's human to wonder, okay, yeah, but I'd still be saying, okay, but what next? So now what do we do? You look around and, you know, Noah could take a census of all of humanity in as long as the time it took him to count to eight, right? On two hands, he could count everybody in the world. And they would need something, right? They're starting all over again. And so in chapter 9, next week, we'll see what it is that God believes they need. Because he knows they need something, those eight. We find out two things. We'll unpack it next week. But he knows they need instruction. And by the way, the first instruction is going to be fruitful and multiply. Not only to the animals, but to the humans. Be fruitful and multiply. We need to repopulate the earth. But there are four other instructions that God gives to preserve and prosper humanity. So God knows they need instruction, and he'll give it to them. We'll see it again in chapter 9. But the second thing that they need is a promise. And God understands that. And he's motivated to give it to them. It's called a covenant. And it's called the Noahic covenant. He's going to promise them. Let me read it for you. And again, next week we'll unpack it. Chapter 9, verse 9. And then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, I now establish my covenant with you and with your descendants after you, and with every living creature that was with you, the birds, the livestock, and all the wild animals, and all those that came out of the ark with you, every living creature on earth. I establish my covenant with you. Here it is. Never again. Never again will all life be destroyed by the waters of a flood. Never again will there be a flood to destroy the earth. I have set my rainbow in the clouds, and it will be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. Whenever I bring the clouds over the earth and the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will remember my covenant between me and you and all living creatures of every kind. Never again, he repeats, will the waters become a flood to destroy all of life. Well, there's the covenant. So again, next week, we'll take a look at the instructions of God and also the deep meaning and significance of the covenant that God made with Noah and what impact that has on our lives. But, like I said, everything would be new for Noah. And the best thing God could do for Noah was reassuring him that he, God, was worthy of Noah's trust. The best thing that God could do for Noah wasn't to give him the details of the year to come. The best thing God could give to Noah was his word, his promise. 2021 was rough for all of us. And in our lifetime, this has to be one of the greatest seasons of uncertainty, confusion, and division, right? We've all maybe felt like we're drifting a bit. At least it can seem that way. Things aren't as certain as they used to be. At least it seems that way. But of your particular life, I don't know what you've gained in the last year. I don't know what you've lost in the last year. I don't know what you've had to fight through, what's caused you fear, anxiety, or concern. But my friend, what Noah needed most is what you and I need most. The simple reassurance that our God is worth trusting. Why could Noah trust God? Because God brought him through a global deluge. Global righteous judgment. God spared him. So he had to conclude, as traumatic as the experience was, all right, God spared me. I can trust him. And then God gave him the sign of his covenant that he'd never flood the earth again with a rainbow. So what's God trying to do? Establish in Noah the confidence Noah would need to move forward, regardless of what the new year would bring. And my friends, God's given us a sign as well, a sign that he's worthy to be trusted, a sign that we can put our hopes in him, even though we don't know the details of the year to come. And the sign for us is the cross of Jesus Christ. You see, if God would spare us, but not his own son, it should tell us that regardless of what lies before us, collectively, individually, in this new year, he can be trusted because he spared our lives and now offered us new life and eternity. My friend, your God can be trusted. And so I would encourage you and myself as well, all of us, let's trust like Noah trusted. Don't demand answers. Become a person that worships. Don't push God for details. Trust him every day, but be a worshiper every day. Be grateful for your forgiveness. Be grateful for the life that you have that you got only in Jesus. There was only one door in that ark that led to Noah's salvation. And there's only one door in life that leads to salvation. And Jesus tells it to us. He says, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. He is the one door. And if you walk through that door, you have already received what's most important, eternal life. And if God has been willing to give that to you, you can trust him for this temporal life that remains on earth. So trust like Noah trusted. Begin this year in renewed worship of the God who remembers your name and who calls you his beloved. And as David writes in Psalm 29, how does he write in Psalm 29? You see, COVID's hitting my brain. That's the verse where he says, here we go. I'm laughing at myself now. God sat as king at the flood. That means he's in control of it. Yes, the Lord sits as king forever. Wow, that's this next year, 2022, that's part of forever. Anyways, he loves you. I love you. And so much for smooth conclusions. But why don't I pray for us as we close? Heavenly Father, thank you for just the life of Noah and how we can be just inspired and encouraged, literally given courage, encouraged by his life. I thank you for my brothers, my sisters. God, I thank you for any guest that's with us today. Encourage them especially. God, let them know that this is a place that they can make their home if they choose to. They're always welcome here. And we pray that your Spirit would continue to move in our midst so that the world could know, even through us, that there is a Savior, and His name is Jesus. And it's in Jesus, our Savior's name, we pray. Amen. Amen. Hey, well, the Lord bless you. I look forward to seeing you this coming week. But we're going to spend the next few minutes sing a couple songs together. So why don't you stand as the band comes back out.
Just alone, faultless stand.